To what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another, we played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not mourn. For John came, neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came, eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent, and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal them. Come to me, all ye that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and there is great good news in this passage, but it will only sound like good news to those who know they need to hear it. It probably will not sound like good news to the self-made man or woman who believes they have it all together. They have gotten where they are in life through their own hard work and initiative, and those others who haven't done as well just haven't figured out how to do it as they have. Have you ever seen a yoke? It is generally put on oxen to help them pull a load together. It reins both oxen in as it's fastened around both of their necks. It keeps them focused on the task at hand and prevents them from roaming away. It is a reminder to anyone who can see that team of oxen that the job is bigger than any one ox can bear. So they need each other. The burden is shared. More is done together. As he so often did, Jesus is using here an image his hearers would have been able to understand easily and at once, from the simplest listener to the greatest. He is saying that the life of discipleship, the life to which he is inviting them and us, is not a solitary journey, even for those who might be rather secluded from the world. For the Christian, for the one who has come to follow Christ, he is the one, the Holy One, taking his place at the other side of the yoke. The journey is shared, the load becomes lighter, new perspective is gained, more can be accomplished. There is good news here. This is a beautiful picture of the life of humble yet exalted service. This is a picture of going out into the world partly under power of our own steam, our smarts, or drive, or courage, or capacity to risk, or unique combination of successes and failures and wisdom gleaned from them that we bring. Yes, to all of that, but not all of that alone. The person who will find this to be good news will be the one who has found that he or she does not have all the answers, that no matter how hard they work, they can't always get it right, or get everything done that they have to do, that they can't love as they would like, or remain as hopeful as they yearn to be, or be as compassionate and understanding of challenging people that they would like to be. That they cannot ignore the prospect of approaching death, as they might hope. In other words, these words from Jesus and the promise they entail are good news for those who've seen the limits of trying to be the self-made man or woman. This is good news to the person looking for community and meaning and purpose and hope. These words were certainly good news to St. Paul, who in perhaps the most honest and vulnerable passage in all of Scripture, Romans 7, admits that he just cannot be good enough on his own, that whenever he wants to do good, evil lies close at hand. He is basically describing an internal civil war, which I believe most of us will be able to understand and appreciate, because it is like our own wars. When we want to do good or right or holy, so often evil lies close at hand. He gets to the heart of the matter when he cries out, "Who will deliver me from this body of death?" These words of Jesus are good news to the person who realizes that we can do more together than apart, both as a community called to follow Jesus and as individual believers experiencing the other half of our code to be fulfilled by Him. And yet, the lines, the demarcations between who will and who won't find this to be good news are not always that clean and clear. Even those of us who strive to be believers are not always on the right side of the yoke. We forget. We act as if we were self-made. We try to pull the load on our own. We neglect the life of prayer and study and service. We forget that we are on a spiritual journey and the horizon is always moving. We forget the burden side of the promise as well. Being yoked to someone else, whether a spouse or a community or the Lord of the universe, implies unmistakably a certain loss of freedom. And we do not like that. It is an image that runs contrary to the spirit of the age, and that spirit being the self-made man or woman. Perhaps the church displays the yoked image most clearly in baptism, where we are buried with Christ in his death and rise from the waters to join in his resurrection. And then, following very ancient tradition, we anoint the newly baptized with the oil of chrism, blessed and set apart by the bishop for this purpose, with the words, "You are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked, yoked, joined as Christ's own forever." In baptismal preparation, I often challenge those with whom I'm meeting to consider an image where we might see such a branding taking place. And rather quickly, they often think of old Western movies and the branding of cattle. So at the heart of our chrismation is a deeply, unpolitically correct image. That we are not the self-made man or woman. That we were bought with a price. That life is sacred and with meaning and purpose. And we are called to embrace it fully. We are not our own. There is a call upon our lives. Now, this does not mean a mindless following by any means, but a reminder who we are and whose we are. And yet, the yoke is still very clearly a yoke in all areas of our lives. But Jesus at the same time says it is gentle and light. How can this be? How can there be a yoke? And yet, how can it be gentle and light? It's a bit of a paradox. Perhaps the yoke is most fundamentally admitting that we need to be yoked. Perhaps that is the yoke. Admitting that we do do not have all the answers, that we are not the self-made man or woman, that we do not have to make ourselves acceptable or worthwhile to God, not based on our works. Many scholars over the centuries have argued that Jesus was comparing his yoke to the heavy yoke of legalistic burden imposed on the people by the Pharisees. Remember later when he speaks of how they lay heavy burdens upon the people, burdens almost impossible to bear. He's saying, compared to that, his yoke is easy and his burden light. That was the yoke that St. Paul found to be the case. It was a yoke that the great theologian Paul Tillich was exploring in one of his most famous books, The Shaking of the Foundations, and one of his most famous sermons, You Are Accepted. I have quoted from it here from this pulpit in smaller portion before, but I offer a longer portion today because I believe Mr. Tillich came to understand what the yoke of Jesus meant. He says the following. We cannot transform our lives unless we allow them to be transformed by that stroke of grace. It happens or it does not happen. And certainly it does not happen if we try to force it upon ourselves, just as it shall not happen so long as we think in our self-complacency that we have no need of it. Grace strikes us when we are in great pain and restlessness. It strikes us when we walk through the dark valley of a meaningless and empty life. It strikes us when we feel that our separation is deeper than usual because we have violated another life, a life which we loved, or from which we were estranged. It strikes us when our disgust for our own being, our indifference, our weakness, our hostility, and our lack of direction and composure have become intolerable to us. It strikes us when year after year the longed for perfection of life does not appear, when the old compulsions reign within us as they have for decades, when despair destroys all joy and courage. Sometimes, at that moment, a wave of light breaks into our darkness and it is as though a voice were saying, "You are accepted. You are accepted. Accepted by that which is greater than you and the name of which you do not know. Do not ask for the name now. Perhaps you will find it later. Do not try to do anything now. Perhaps later you will do much. Do not seek for anything. Do not perform anything. Do not intend anything. Simply accept the fact that you are accepted." If that happens to us, we experience grace. After such an experience, we may not be better than before, and we may not believe more than before, but everything is transformed. In that moment, grace conquers sin, and reconciliation bridges the gulf of estrangement. Nothing is demanded of this experience, no religious or moral or intellectual presupposition, nothing but acceptance. He doesn't say it, Mr. Tillich, but I can imagine in that moment as he wrote those words. And scholars tell us that if you examine the original text of that sermon, he wrote in the margin, "Preaching to myself." You can imagine the yoke being placed around his neck. A yoke that he did find to be gentle and light. In the name of the